What's clinical manifestation mean? Signs and symptoms. So signs, we're going to be able to measure. Symptoms, the patient is going to relay to us how they feel about something. But those signs and symptoms result from the consolidation of the alveoli, the capillary membrane thickens during a pneumonia process, atelectasis, excessive bronchial secretions, usually during the resolution stage of pneumonia, not at the beginning. Now, I slid this picture in here because it's showing normal. Again, it's got a cross-section of an asinus. So there is the bronchial and then the air spaces. And they're not too big. They're not too small. They contain air. And then the air moves out and moves back in. But when we get a pneumonia, then we get inflammation and thickening of the alveolar wall. We get this fluid and possibly pus and bacterial debris, cellular debris that actually collects in the asinus. Now, what can't happen because of that in that area? Gas exchange. And what kind of defect does that create? VQ mismatch, shunt, or dead space? Shunt. What happens to the patient's PaO2? It goes down. What happens when you give them more oxygen? It stays down. So we have to find out what's causing the pneumonia and give the appropriate antimicrobial to eradicate it. Does that make sense to everybody? Now, you may find it easier to look in your book. So this is on page 7. And when they created this edition, they left these slides out, or either they put them in another area. So just kind of bear with me if you can. That's why I left them in there, because they weren't in your book. Oh, here we go. Here we go. Turn to page 132. Instead of putting them in every chapter, they put them in this one chapter at the beginning. So we're going to have a lot of redundancy up here, but I want you to think about this. The anatomic alteration in the lung is consolidation. There is something inside the alveoli. Pathophysiologic mechanisms. The primary mechanism is the initiation of the immune response, the inflammatory response. White blood cells are coming to the site. The ventilation perfusion ratio is going down. So there's more perfusion than there is ventilation, and that's obvious to see because air can't get where? In the alveoli. We also have shunting going on. As blood passes by these alveolar unit, that did not participate in gas exchange. We have venous admixture. What happens with venous admixture?
What is it?
An oxygenated blood back to the heart.
Huh?
An oxygenated blood back to the heart.
Okay. So basically, when we mix blood in the pulmonary circulation that participated in gas exchange, we expect the PaO2 to be what? 100 millimeters of mercury. When the blood flows past these consolidated units, it comes out 40 millimeters of mercury. When you take 100 and add it to 40, you get 140. When you divide that by 2, you get 70. It's not that simple, but the thought process is when you have venous admixture, your PaO2 is going to end up being lower when it leaves the pulmonary vein to go to the left heart. Decreased lung capacity. What kind of disease is this? It is a restrictive lung disease. All the volumes are going to be decreased. Increased lung density, which means when I look at it on the chest x-ray, I'm going to see these wider areas. I'm going to see a more dense secondary pathophysiologic mechanisms, or the hypoxia is going to stimulate what? The peripheral receptors. Y'all with me? PaO2 gets down to 60 millimeters of mercury. We're not talking about COPD patients anymore, although we could be a COPD patient with pneumonia. The deflation reflex is stimulated and the irritant reflex is stimulated. We're going to get some sneezing, maybe coughing, but again, coughing typically doesn't happen until the pneumonia is resolving. Now, the immune response is going to lead to a fever. Does that make sense? The VQ imbalance, shunting, hypoxemia, venous admixture, that is going to lead to the sympathomimetic stimulation. We're going to have increased heart rate, increased cardiac output, increased blood pressure. The ventilatory rate is also going to go up. Because of the decreased lung capacity, what happens to all of our volumes? They decrease. Now, one of the things, opacity again means white, lucent means black, and I think Mr. Rich is going to try to spend some time at the end of this semester on chest x-rays. Air bronchograms, I'll show you in just a minute. What kind of breath sounds is the patient going to have? Crackles, not coarse crackles, but fine crackles. A dull percussion note, maybe bronchial breath sounds. And what about tactile fremitus if that was performed? It would be increased. Okay. ABGs, initially when a patient has hypoxemia and the peripheral chemoreceptors are stimulated, the patient breathes deeper and faster and they hyperventilate. they continue down the path and the pneumonia is not resolving, it will lead to acute ventilatory failure. Now I'm going to hold off on these O2 indices for a little bit.
It says decrease bicarbonate. Wouldn't the bicarbonate just be normal?
Yes, there's a couple things I don't like about this book. As good as it is, that's one of the things. Initially, when the patient is hyperventilating, the bicarbonate will be normal.
Yes,
there is potential for it to go slightly outside of range because of the CO2, how CO2 is transported in the body. But it's not the kidneys doing anything with the bicarbonate. It is the CO2 transport system that's causing it. And it won't be off by that much, but it may be off by enough that you are going to say that there's a metabolic involvement. And that's okay. Now, I'm not going to go through this whole slide because what I want you to see is when this particular event happens, alveolar capillary membrane thickness, it kind of leads to the same things as